Hello all you scrappy mechanics out there, my name is Etalyx and I'm finally ready to show you the newest iteration of my mobile base. I say finally because I have over 20 hours logged in Scrap Mechanic now and this is all I have to show for it, so you better enjoy it. You may have noticed the out of place looking second story in the last video and wondered what that's all about, what am I hiding? Well, it's time to find out what secrets lie in wait. Welcome! Wait, what does that sign say? You are not welcome! Just kidding, you guys can stop by my fake Do Not Enter house anytime you want. I took the liberty of rebuilding the stairs into more efficient, compact variation and combined it with the switch for the automatic door. That was my first ever tinkering creation here in Scrap Mechanic. Now what's new in here? What have I done this time to try to blow your minds? I gotta keep one up in myself, you know? Wait a second, where's the driver's seat? Did you turn this into a house plane? No. Skull and crossbones? Danger? Falling objects? I get the impression maybe I shouldn't be standing here. Have you guys ever pushed this button before? Deploying before your eyes is the brand new cockpit elevator. I worked tirelessly to try to bring this to fruition. Let's jump into the driver's seat. There's that purr of the engines underneath us. I feel the rumble already. Let's flip the switch again and rise to the perch. The automatic unfolding shades will shield your eyes from all of the sun's harmful rays, and we have a very increased viewing angle here. In fact, we could drive in first person if we wanted to. Take a look at the revised house car. Doesn't that look so much better up here? I've even got a passenger seat in case I ever have any company wanting to ride shotgun. But before we take another closer inspection of the elevator, start talking about sliding doors, which I want to focus on today, there's something I need to do. You think in Etalyx, you are not far enough away from that ramp? I don't care, because this houseboat is far too large to be concerned with things like distance. We almost cleared the gap. Now we're gonna be stuck in the ravine as our hero thrashes about. Yes, he's actually physically animated, so if you hit left, he swings left. If you hit right, he swings right, which is just a really cool touch. Unfortunately, this vehicle is almost at the end of the line. I don't think there's anything else I can do to my base car because, simply put, it's too taxing on the game's engine. When I put all of these contraptions together, say for example, I drop the cockpit back down, notice how I had to lift the stairs slightly so that it didn't catch on and push the stairs down, like, let's say we activate the door, the wheels, the blinds, and the lift all at the same time, the game just can't handle it. Apparently this creation is just too quote-unquote complex. So unfortunately for those of you who can dream even bigger than me, you might have a wall that you run into until some optimization passes are done in the future to make the physics more agreeable. Because just a second ago, while I was driving this car around in exactly the same configuration, I had 40 to 50 frames per second. Right now, I have 16 to 18. It's very volatile, and it is the cause of me having to restart my game 3 to 4 times just to get everything to work. Now, the car crashing and the wheel turning underneath me is completely my fault, and I take full responsibility. Let's get into learning how to make elevators, how to make perfectly sliding doors, so that I can save myself from this frame rate hell. I might actually need someone to rescue me from this car crash. Got like a jumping puzzle here. I don't think I can jump through this doorway, though. I'm gonna have to claw my way out like a hamster. Wait a second. I can lift the car up. Now I'm just being crushed by the full weight of the car. Now that I've emerged from that fiery crash, mostly intact, let's take a closer examination of what you're probably most interested in, the elevator. What's significant about this system is that it allows you to push and pull objects in a straight line. So there's no curves here. Watch the difference between the quote-unquote latch system we used in the last video. Notice how this does not go straight up or straight down, it kind of curves at an angle. Now compare that to the elevator, which starts in one position and moves in a straight line to the second position. How do we accomplish this? That is what we are going to learn today. How to make a slide system. And I have to thank the developers of the game for this because they taught me how to do it. I didn't know myself. I had to ask them and they're like, this is how, because I'm not really that smart when it comes to these mechanically inclined games. I just usually get something I want to do, like make unfolding stairs or an elevator cockpit, and I build it. Maybe some of you Kerbals out there could put this launch pad to good use with the help of a multi-stage thruster-based contraption. A little bit beyond me right now, so maybe in a future video. For now, we're going to focus on making a simple slide. We're going to start with just a pole. Doesn't matter how tall this pole is, because this is just going to be the foundation upon which we set our switch and our controller. And they have to be connected to the same contraption, because if you put something over here, you cannot connect it up, because they need to be able to draw a dotted line between them on the same machine. So let's destroy this. And from here on out, we're just going to need bearings and a few extra arms. Three bearings in total should do the trick. So the first one, doesn't matter which side we put it on, but I'm putting it here because we're going to have the sliding arm be about three spaces away. And you'll see what I mean here in just a moment. Let's build the first arm, and I'm going to use wood here so that you guys can distinguish each arm from the other as I bonk myself on the head. Just want to show you. It is indeed on the swivel at the moment. We're going to hook it up so it remains nice and taut. I've made this four blocks long, and this is a conscious decision you need to make. This actually matters. The first one doesn't. The swinging arm does, because if I make this four, the next arm needs to be the same length. So we're going to have a total push distance of seven blocks. How do I come up with seven? Should become obvious here in just a moment when we finish this little example. Our third material, we're going to use the caution tape. I'll hook that bearing up as well. Wrong thing. That's the controller. It's purple. And then we only need one more. So how do I know where to place the bearings? Doing opposites. So the first one's on top, the second one needs to be at the opposite end, the third one needs to be on the opposite end, you get the idea. So just make sure you follow that little pattern, and you're good to go. So now what we need is one final bearing, which we've got, one final material, and I want this arm to just be straight in this direction. Now this, it doesn't matter, because it's still going to be pushed the same distance. It's going to be pushed seven blocks. The reason it's seven is because 4 plus 4 is 8. But on one of these blocks, we have a bearing. So when the swivel happens, you're not going to get two individual blocks in length. You're going to only have one because there's a swivel here. Okay, if you still don't understand, just be patient. You'll see. So let's go ahead and make the arm. Again, doesn't matter how long it is, but I'll use the extra material so you can see it. And it's going to be remaining at this horizontal position, not going to be changing. So imagine that this is the arm that is going to hold something greater, like a door, for example. Now, I'm hesitant to do this right now because I want to show you what each stage of our controller settings looks like. We're going to begin with the first bearing and manipulating that. I want it to go 90 degrees to the negative. So I want it to swing underneath and up at a right angle. So let's start there and see what that looks like. 90 degrees, flip the switch. Okay, everything is moving, but this is where the magic happens. We want the other bearings to counter the movements of the former. In fact, we want this second bearing, this caution tape line, to extend out this direction. To do that, it needs to go 180 degrees opposite of the first. So we're going to try 180 degrees towards the positive. Let's try 90 first, just to see what happens, just to show you an example. Okay, you're starting to see how this might function. 90 is not far enough, though. That's just keeping it at a vertical position. We want it to go horizontal, don't we? Upping it to 180. That was really quick. I'm impressed. We have our extending folding arm, and one step remains. We just need to counter the movements of our second bearing with the third bearing. You can see that we need negative on this bearing towards the red so that it unfolds at the exact same time as 1 and 2 in the same general direction so that it maintains that horizontal position. Again, opposites. So instead of top, bottom, top, it's negative, positive, negative in my case. And now that the arm is extended horizontally, we have before your very eyes the mechanism, the slide that enables elevators and sliding doors to be built. Very simple, very compact. There might even be a way to make it more compact, but this is what I was taught by the developers, and I've implemented it to, I think, great effect in my elevator inside the house. So how can we turn this into a giant moving door? Well, funny you should ask. Kind of like this, actually. So if you want to build this up, doesn't matter if it's touching the ground even. All right, let's try activating it now. Wonderful. Okay, and let's make the door, of course, wider. That's about a good size for a sliding door, maybe even one more in length. Good. And now let's conceal everything else that we have built here with I would use steel, but let's just use wood. It's a little bit more stark in contrast. So it's going to be sliding, right? So we want to make sure we don't completely obscure it. But we do want to obscure our little building here. So like I said, there's probably a way to make this even more compact. You could probably build one on one side and one on the other for having the door part in two different ways. Let's plop down a new switch right next to the door so we don't have to run all the way around the side, and also conceal this other area over here just to make the effect stronger. Now we just need to hook this up to the controller, and you have a very simple open and close mechanism for a door. Of course, you could change this to a sensor if you wanted to, and there are ways and methods for you to, of course, open it from the other side if you get crafty and creative. What am I talking about? Well, maybe again for another video. That's a bit more complex. I don't really like the sensors myself personally, so I try to avoid them, but may as well show you what they're good for. And I forget that I need to make sure that we connect these two structures and get that noise out of here. Here we go. This does the opposite of what I want. So all we would need to do is set a new starting position. So like negative 90, 180, and negative 90 as well. So what this little bar does, it's separate from the animation of these others in that this is going to be the new default position. So we just flipped them backwards. So it was negative, now it's positive because we set a new starting position for these so you can build this a little bit differently depending on how you would like to do it, of course. What that should do is enable the sensor to actually make sense. Ta-da! Just don't get squished! You gotta Indiana Jones that thing, or else it's gonna pinch you off! So you can get, of course, way more advanced with this. Have two different sides of the door, one go left and one go right. But that is how to create a sliding mechanism, and by extension, an elevator. How to make this into an elevator. Rotate everything to the left. I'll go back into my mobile base, just so you can see that mechanism, that pulley. It's not really a pulley, but it's pulling in a little bit more detail. So I'm gonna sit in first person here, hit that number two switch. So you can see we're lifting the roof ever so slightly because that's how I had to connect it, unfortunately. But look, the same principle applies. It's just all in that caution tape yellow. The pole on the bottom left side of the screen is staying in a straight line. That's what gives the illusion that it's moving perfectly straight. And of course, I mean, it is. The base of this is not wavering left, right, forward, or backwards. But I'm just putting those principles to good use. Did I need it to happen on two sides? No. But I chose to make the effect a little bit more believable when the elevator goes up and down. I really hope you guys enjoyed the newest and possibly last iteration of my mobile base. I say last because the more I add to it, the more complicated it gets, the more my game kind of lags. So I think we need to start on new, fresh, green pastures on a brand new project, preferably with thrusters or some kind of multi-stage device, something like that. If you guys enjoyed this video and you want to see even more Scrap Mechanic in the future, or even have some suggestions for things yet to be tested by me, or that you might want to learn how to do, you can leave those down in the comments below. Let me know what you guys are thinking. Thank you so much for watching. My name is Etalyx, and I'll see you next time, Mechanics.